This is not the South. This is not the Midwest. This is the true West. The West of cowboys and of westerns, a landscape that America shares with nowhere else on Earth. This is the Rio Grande Rift, a tear in the Earth's crust through which the Rio Grande flows south towards Mexico. The river has an iconic place in the American imagination. It marks much of the southern border, of course, but also the beginning of a new frontier west of the Rockies, a frontier that rolled ever westward as the pioneers, gold diggers, oil men and homesteaders transformed in a matter of decades the lawless Wild West of legend into the most affluent and vibrant place on the planet.
Talk about sure-footed. You've timed this very well, I have to say.
From here in the foothills of the Rockies in northern New Mexico, I will drop into the spectacular deserts and canyons of Arizona, Utah, and Nevada before crossing the Sierra Nevada Mountains, finally to reach the Pacific Ocean at San Francisco, California. On the outskirts of Taos, a favorite haunt of artists and hippies, a very American phenomenon has sprung up on the semi-arid desert of the high mesas. The Earthships have landed and put down their rather untidy roots. Born of the counterculture movement of the 60s and 70s, these eco-friendly dwellings are still in the forefront of sustainable housing, not least due to the inspiration and dedication of founder Mike Reynolds.
We launched about 38 years ago into this realm and just kept going deeper because we kind of got our eyes opened by early media talking about clear-cutting timber and early oil shortage, talking about energy, and we just kind of moved in this direction. And then, of course, more timber issues, more energy issues, more water issues, more pollution issues, more garbage issues, more housing issues. So we just kept going. We saw we were on a path that could lead to our own safety in the future.
Goodness me. Is the scale of it so surprising?
We're this one's a little larger scale than a typical home, because we're trying to demonstrate a large portion of the square footage for food production.
Including herbs, I see.
Yeah, herbs and fruits and grapes. There's actually grapes starting over here. Bananas, vegetables. Pretty much the idea is a family of four could live here with no utility bill whatsoever, be totally comfortable, have plenty of water and plenty of food.
You've got lots of bottles everywhere into the cement or into the adobe, is it?
Cement and adobe. The wall outside is bottles laid in mud, which you could totally do in Africa without any cement whatsoever.
As are the cans.
Yeah, and it just dries and it becomes a bottle and mud wall.
And which is both beautiful and, of course, somehow rather a good symbolic reminder of all the detritus that we tend to leave behind and not do anything with. And you're saying you use photovoltaic, i.e. solar panels, is it?
Solar panels, they're pretty common. But the reason they're not used that much is because most housing requires a tremendous amount of power for heating, cooling, and pumps and all kinds of things like that, whereas these homes do most of everything for themselves. So what little bit of power we need is easy to achieve with solar photovoltaic cells.
And you've got here, you've got, you know, all the normal kitchen things, lights and coffee machine and cooker and so on.
And yeah, and flat screen TV and computers. In other words, you don't have to do without anything to live completely independent of all fossil fuel utilities.
That is amazing. How is it? Is it done through there, the electricity?
This back hallway is kind of a buffer zone between the living spaces and the exterior walls, and it does show how the walls are built in this home. They're earth ram tires. You could drive a pickup truck into that and, you know, go through the windshield yourself. And there actually is the water organizing system with the pumps and filters, so that you have conventional household hot and cold running water.
And do you recycle water after?
And yes, we do. We have a limited amount of water in this arid climate, so we take the water from the cisterns, run it through our filters, take a shower in it, then it runs into these planters that are called tanacle cells.
But the plants actually filter the gray water, as they call it.
They filter the gray water and actually clean it up. So we flush the toilet with water you took a shower in yesterday. But it's clean. It's not drinkable, but it's clean enough that you can't tell it. Certainly clean enough for a toilet flushing.
Yes.
And then that water goes out into a conventional septic system.
Right.
Which then, rather than going into a drain field or to a municipal sewage area, goes into more outdoor botanical cells that are used for landscaping. So no sewage ever leaves the home. It's used by plants.
And that's very unlike the way we do things in the 20th and 21st century, where we like to send our poo away as far as possible and not really to think about it and to think about the enormous quantities of it that we produce.
Mike's vision of a sustainable, self-reliant lifestyle is gaining wider recognition as both the financial and the environmental cost of oil seems inexorably to rise. Of course, not so long ago, this was the only way to live. Indeed, for hundreds of years before Europeans invaded these lands, the local Indian population had adapted to this harsh environment by banding together in adobe, or mud wall villages, pueblos in Spanish, and hence their name, the Pueblo Indians. New Mexico has one of the highest percentages of Native Americans of any state. I'm in Santa Fe, which was America's very first capital city when it was founded in 1610 by the Spanish and given the splendid name La Villa de la Santa Fe de San Francisco de Assis. Today, it is the state capital of New Mexico, but it's justifiably proud of its Pueblo Indian and Spanish heritage. It is the architectural jewel in the crown of the Southwest, and even if the adobe style is a spot overindulged, it makes a change to be able to walk around an American city.
Well, this is just another old Santa Fe courtyard stuffed with colorful knickknacks for the tourist trade, you might think. But actually, this was once the most secret address in the world. It was simply a post office box, 1663, and it was the only conduit to a rather special place in the mountains. So this is the center of nuclear America, the nucleus, if you like, the cradle. It's where it all began. It's where mankind first learned to harness the power of the atom. Both a terrible and a magnificent event, I suppose. And that building there, that half-timbered building, was in the 1930s and 40s a school. It actually boasts such alumni as the literary figures Gore Vidal and William Burroughs. And it was that school that was bought by the US government and formed the kernel of the Los Alamos Nuclear Research Laboratory.
Quark bar in Los Alamos. Those of you who are good at physics might remember that a quark is an elementary particle named after a James Joyce word. I don't know what this place makes me think of. There's something very moving, very extraordinary about the photographs of the pioneers of Los Alamos. It's a kind of optimism in big science, and there's an optimism in being American. And when the two come together, you create an astonishing energy, rather like the energy that they created when they split that atom and made that first bomb. I suppose some people would think this is a grisly place. It's a place of death. But to me, I see nothing but optimism. That's probably because I believe in science. Many people these days don't. I think America, for all its faults, still does.
Los Alamos still looks after America's nuclear arsenal. But with its $2.5 billion budget and its massive supercomputers, it's at the cutting edge in practically every area of research. Terry Wallace is director of science at the lab.
Oh, that's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. I can't begin to guess what it does, Terry.
So what we really have here is a very fancy electron microscope. So we're allowed to look at materials or prepare the materials and look at them on a submicroscopic level, and at the same time be able to probe it with ions so we can get the chemistry, the dynamics, the materials.
And it's everything from organic matter to wafers of is that mm-hmm. and the other, is it?
The work that's going on in this particular one right now really is concentrated on films in which we can push individual atoms around on the film. Right. And the idea would be able to build atom-based circuits so you could have a quantum computer. So this is actually their
Los Alamos National Laboratory.
They're taking individual hydrogen atoms and moving them. And so those are hydrogen atoms.
You are
that
actually
are spelling,
corralling
right.
a hydrogen atom, pushing it into...
Yes, we grab those with probe tweezers, and we can spell out LANL.
So you have all this power of quantum mathematics behind you and this extraordinary supercomputer. Are there other areas that you're developing?
A substantial effort in what we call living machines. Right. So can we make materials which self-reproduce? Now, the idea there that we're working on right now, and the research is not focused on making living systems, but systems which are self-aware. And so the example I would use is, if we could, instead of having just normal concrete on a bridge, we could have this self-aware material on the outside, it could heal its own cracks with stress, you know, and time comes along. And so I think this is a very realizable dream. Our laboratory is here for one reason, and that's national security science. But to be able to get to the national security science, you have to be at the frontiers of science. And since so much good work is done here, it's attacked about 3.5 million times a day from all the different ways to try to, you know, either probe our information.
Hackers trying to get in.
But they're mainly state-sponsored hackers. And so...
Really? And so countries which we won't name, but let's say they rhyme with China and Russia, actually have people constantly, as it were, hammering at your digital gates, trying to get in.
Exactly.
Oh, my goodness. And so, I dare say Britain does too. When the theory and then the practice of the power of the atom was proved, it was the most momentous moment in science's history, really. Is there anything in science now which will yield equivalent astonishment, do you think, in the future?
The real answer, I mean, we don't understand dark energy.
Right.
So our solar system is filled with dark matter, and we see the interaction with dark energy. And
because energy and matter are, in some sense, consubstantial because of Einstein.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so, potentially, the concept of what we could get from dark energy or the conversion with dark matter could dwarf anything that we see within our particular system of the light matter or what we see.
Leaving the boffins at Los Alamos to ponder the conundrum of dark matter and dark energy, I head for the light, possibly the best light to be found in the entire country. This is Monument Valley, part of the Navajo Indian Reservation that straddles Arizona and Utah. I'm meeting up with Jameson, a Navajo whose family have lived here from long before the coming of the Europeans.
In 1938, John Ford shot his first Western here, Stagecoach, which was also John Wayne's first Western, I think. And then he did 9 more movies here. Have you ever seen any of those movies?
Yeah, I did. It's all because of Mr. Goulding.
Now Mr. Goulding was a trader?
Yeah.
And he was in the 1920s and 30s?
Yeah.
And how did he get John Ford here?
Well, they said that he went around and took pictures of the valley, and then he made a trip down to Hollywood. And then he wasn't really accepted into the office, into the Hollywood, but he slipped the pictures underneath the door. So, when they saw that picture, they were like,
they were amazed by what they saw. Uh-huh. And that's what brought John Ford here?
Yeah.
In the hogan, the traditional home, Jameson's sister Sally has something to show me.
What we do is, like, we want to make a basket. If we don't have material, we had to go out to Colorado or in Utah, but it's still like 300-400 miles.
Really? This is where these trees grow?
Yeah, they have it. So you have to look for something long, like this one.
Right. And it's going to be bendy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so are they quite young?
Yeah, they're still...
They're shoots.
Yeah.
And what's the name of the plant?
This is called sumac.
Sumac. Right.
And then what we do is split them, these three parts like this. It's a lot of work just to do this. But you have to know how to do that. If you don't, you just break them.
Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful. It's like the pith,
See, one shoot becomes six different three. Parts. Good, three, but each one uh-huh. has the pith taken out and you discard it. So it's flat on one side, isn't uh-huh. it? Where you've pulled out the pith.
And then this is the one that we have to put it up and let it dry. And it takes a couple of days to dry. So what we do is we take off the brown top. So this is the one that we use to weave with. This is the one that we colored in. So this is what it is right there.
Oh, yes, and white and black. So those four colors are the ones
yeah.
you use.
And then we start off with sumac, yeah. like this one here.
Oh, so you leave one which you don't peel, you don't uh-huh. divide, and that becomes...
And that's the rods, yeah.
And you coil it up.
And then when you're weaving, this one has to be moist.
Uh-huh.
And then what I do is, and that's to make a hole in here.
Right. Will you let me have a try?
Sure.
I might well screw up. But you don't ever stab that finger by mistake?
Uh-huh.
Do you?
Yeah, my hand's always right here, so.
Oh, right, you keep it out of the way. Okay, put that on my
that
lap.
Way.
Yeah.
Okay, it won't slip around.
Oh, law.
Blindfold.
Okay, so the hole goes here.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Don't poke your knees.
Oh, no, don't. Going to go through. Oops. Okay. Oh, yeah, it's gone through. Yeah. Phew. And that's going to go. Hope the hole's big enough. Through. Oops.
Now pull in the back.
We've got the other side there and pull. Yeah. Oh, I've made my first loop. Is it an important source of income, mm-hmm. this for you?
Yeah.
It is. It's your major mm-hmm. source. And the tourists, how much do you charge? I mean, because they seem very good value to me.
Like if it's like a 20-inch, I sometimes sell it for like 3,000, 6,000.
Yeah.
7,000.
Well, I think it's fantastic. Have you got, you've got ones here.
Yeah, this one is called the traditional ceremonial basket, and they call the wedding basket. Middle is the earth.
Yeah.
And this is the mountain. And this is the rainbow uh-huh. and the clouds. And this one right here, we never close it. We always have a opening.
Yes.
And that's the mind, the spirit line.
Which goes between and through all the different uh-huh. elements. And this is the same thing, but
that's
with different colors. But it's very skillful and lovely. I shall have to buy one now. I may not buy one of your $3,000 ones, though. You can see why Ford was drawn to this place and why Navajo, like Jameson and his family, have no desire to leave. If ever there was a place where humans can feel connected to some sense of the spirit world, this is it. Exposure to the spiritual always leaves me more than usually peckish. Jameson's wife has the answer to my prayers.
And this is Navajo fry bread.
Navajo fry bread, I'm making.
We make the best fry bread in all of East Slope.
Yeah? Family loyalty, but I believe it. I think it's great that you all speak Navajo, because I was up in South Dakota on the reservation with the Gala Lakota.
Yeah.
And they were saying that 10% of the children speak Lakota now, and that's terrible, isn't it?
Yeah.
You lose the language.
A few years back, they were saying that they had a complaint because of our kids kind of forgetting their language.
Really?
So.
You make a big effort now. They're in college and school, everybody learns. Yeah.
You can go ahead and taste some.
Look at those steaks. You know, I'm a bit tempted. Can I taste some of
the bread? Yeah, you can all taste some.
I'll tear a bit off. Oh, my. Lunch is as good as it gets. Oh. Oh. It's light, it's fluffy.
Yeah.
Mm.
soft.
Soft. Yep. Absolutely. Good, isn't it?
Here, you can help yourself, all of you.
Oh, the rain. Wow.
All right, here's the plate.
And what a place to eat.
Oh, yeah.
What isn't it?
Oh. Quiet.
Yeah.
But what's amazing to me is that you've managed to live here, right in the middle of Monument Valley, and have a private family life, while today there are probably, what, 1,000 tourists up there in cars going round, and you wouldn't know they were there, would you?
Some of them really want to step inside and talk to the family. Yeah. Sometimes they'll do that. They'll just not walk over here and, you know, just say a friendly hello, but, you know, we just go along with it.
You don't mind that?
Yeah.
Because you wouldn't go down an American street in a city and just open somebody's door and go, hello.
Bordering the Navajo reservation, Lake Powell stretches for 250 miles in a filigree pattern of extraordinary beauty.
Looking at these ancient rocks, it's easy to think this would be a scene you could imagine thousands of years ago, but actually, it's only been visible for the last 30-odd years. This is the completion of the great project of damming the Colorado River. And this is an artificial lake, a man-made lake. It's the Colorado River risen up into an old canyon. And maybe that's what adds its spooky kind of atmosphere. The fact that there is no life that's grown up with the lake, it's a new lake, so nature hasn't yet caught up with it. Maybe in 100 years' time, the kingfishers and the grasses and the reeds and things will make this a proper aquatic environment. But at the moment, it's more like an album cover or a computer-generated image. Conceivably eggy. Fucking hell. The one word in the American phrase, as you know, probably is over easy. And over easy is when you flip it over and just barely cook it, just to get the, you know, the runny bits off the top cooked. The problem with that is the word easy. How do I get that over? It's like, oh, come on. Now it's broken. Well, it's not exactly broken, but half the white's sheared off it and If I flip that over, I guarantee it's going to burst in a... Not bad. Extraordinary thing about Lake Powell is that it's not better known. It's as if someone had filled the Grand Canyon with water. Admittedly, we're not high season now, but we're about the only boat on this huge stretch of water.
What do you call that?
That's Navajo Mountain.
Navajo Mountain, that's very particular to your people.
That's another one of our sacred mountains.
Right.
And of course, the Rainbow Bridge is sacred.
Rob Bighorse, my Navajo captain, wants to show me something very special to his people, the largest natural bridge in the world.
The Greek goddess of the rainbow was called Iris, which is why we call the eye, the eye, the iris, because it's like a rainbow. All the spectrum is there, the colours, if you look at it. So would you like to tell me about the story of that?
Legend has it that there was a little boy that got lost here, and to make it across, back across, the deities made a rainbow, and he made it back across, and after that they just turned it into stone.
And since then it's been sacred to the Navajo?
It's been sacred to the Navajos, yes.
And how is that sacred nature shown? By never
go over it or underneath it.
Right.
Yes.
I read somewhere that actually you could fit the Statue of Liberty under there.
Yes, you can.
Western science has its own explanation. And yes. What is that? Is that it's called by wind or water?
It's by water.
Water. So at one point the river, they say, was high enough to have carved this out through the rock?
Yes, it just carved right through it, and there you have it.
Absolutely staggering. Mm-hmm. I've jacuzzied my way around the world, but this just about beats it all, I have to say. You know, there are 1,900 miles of shoreline on this man-made lake. It's quite extraordinary. Very American, isn't it, to do it in this kind of brash style? And I have to say, there's a part of me that is entirely suited to this Mr. Toad-like way of getting around a lake. Others would pull on paddles and oars, but not I. Leaving the otherworldly landscape and my gloriously gargantuan houseboat, I realize just how much Americans are used to supersizes in everything. The distances out west are just vast. So it's with relish that I'm going to hitch a ride the 400 miles south to Tucson, Arizona, in another supersized form of American transport, the Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress. Cloudless skies of the West make it the perfect place for flying, and the United States Air Force has bases dotted all about. I'm heading for Davis-Monthan in Tucson. You know, the bomber crews had a really tough life. There was nothing glamorous or romantic about being a member of a bomber crew. There are five, six or seven of them, depending on the nature of the flight, and they all had incredibly difficult jobs to do. They were very scientific, very mathematical jobs. They were constantly having to adjust for magnetic deviations and the compass. They were having to fly by dead reckoning with pieces of pencil and paper to find out where they were. They were having to work out their height and their glide and climb attacks and all kinds of technical stuff. There was nothing of the dashing warrior of the air about them as there was perhaps for the fighter pilots. And indeed, they never really got the thanks at the end of the war for the job they were asked to do. I suppose we were all too embarrassed about it. Raining fire on civilians was not something we should be perhaps proud of. As you might imagine, there are quite a few Air Force bases throughout the West. The guaranteed hours of sunlight make it an ideal place to send young pilots for training. But there are other functions too. And this Air Force base is very special indeed. It's where American airplanes go when they're retired. Over 3,000 of them, worth an estimated $30 billion, injected with synthetic rubber and wrapped in protective cling film. But don't be fooled. At the single sound of a bugle, they could rise again to serve their country. They're not dead, they're just mothballed, sealed up for the time being. Line after line of them. Fighters, bombers, attack aircraft, surveillance aircraft, supply aircraft, helicopters, fast jets, great lumbering transports. Spooky. When I was a child, I used to think these tall cactuses were the entire invention of cartoonists. I didn't really believe there could be such a thing. And to see them now in virtual forests, Such an iconic American site, isn't it? It's called something like Carmenigia Gigantica. And they have white flowers and an edible red fruit, but they don't seem to be fruiting at the moment. And they're very often rude, of course, because they've got two arms and other protuberances. If there was an Arizona that life, then Esther Ransom would be receiving rude cactuses every week. But they're noble. Some of them are up to 45 feet. Enormous they are.
Some of these saguaro cacti are over 100 years old and were well into their middle age when the Tucson Film Studios started life here as an alternative base to Hollywood for shooting westerns. Since 1939, the backlot has been graced by everyone from Jimmy Stewart to the Duke, John Wayne himself. The studios are still used for filming, as well as being an attraction for us out-of-towners.
Fancy stagecoach you got there, mister.
It is pretty fancy, isn't it? You don't see too many around these parts.
Never seen one in my life.
You should come to London. You see hundreds of them. Mindy, we don't see too many cowboys in London, so it's a fair exchange.
I thought I told you. We don't like your kind in this town. You see, me and my boys here, we run this town. We don't like you here.
Yes, well, you've told me a number of things in the past, Marshal, and none of them have left me singularly impressed.
Well, looks like we outnumber you 3-1. So I best you just get on your horse, you ride out of my town.
Well, that seems to have evened the odds up a little, doesn't it?
Fine by me, Fry. Wanted to kill you anyway.
Oh, really? Many have tried, Marshal. Few have succeeded. Only two, in recorded time, have succeeded in killing me, and even they didn't do it very well.
I'll do it right this time.
Make your move. Go! Oh! Oh! Oh, that hurt. Oh, it's rather like, oh, oh.
Think about that next time.
Excuse me, I think I may be having to have a death scene. Oh, sweet mother of mercy, is this the end of Stephen Fry?
Oh,
oh no. You win, Marshal. Yes, we showed that sheriff a thing or two, didn't we, Spinoza? He'd never even heard of phenomenology. Can you imagine such a thing? Let's see what this town has to offer us, shall we?
Eschewing my taxi for an eagle's eye view, I travel the 350 miles north towards Las Vegas, Nevada, passing over that most famous stretch of the Colorado River, the Grand Canyon. At its westernmost end, the river is once again tamed, this time by the Hoover Dam, an extraordinary engineering feat born out of the great public works after the Depression. It's the dam that has created the water and light that powers the oasis of wealth, beauty, opulence and vulgarity that is Las Vegas today.
Absolutely wonderful. Look at that.
And of course, you have the Rio and the Palms.
Sin City, as Vegas was known in the days of Bugsy Malone and the Rat Pack, has evolved. Today, less than half its revenues come from gambling. Business conventioneers are the new high rollers, and with them come a host of arcane management rituals. The newest entrant in this lucrative field is an outfit called Spy Games.
Mr. Fry?
Yes?
There's been an incident.
Really? Well, do come in. Incident?
Would you take the time to read the letter, please? Are you alone?
Yes, I am. Tragically.
They call me Trixie.
Do they? Trixie, right. Mr. Fry, you have been personally selected to join forces with the notorious Las Vegas crime boss known as The Boss. You will be acting as our mole in a newly formed group of CCI special agents that think they can outsmart us.
Here's the deal, Mr. Fry.
Right.
There's been a kidnapping.
Yeah?
I've done the kidnapping. The problem is that the agents are getting a little too close. I need to know that I can trust you.
Right. The agents of?
The agents of the agency.
Are getting too close.
They're getting too close. To me, to the boss.
Right.
I need your help.
I'm on your side, am I?
Yes, I hope so.
Right.
Can I trust you?
Can Trixie trust me? Can I trust her? This is Vegas, where the unthinkable, if you're not careful, becomes a reality.
Sir, why do you have your glasses on your paper?
Oh, I use these for improvement.
Why aren't they on your
face?
Why aren't they around your neck?
Because they're only necessary for when I'm reading. I have presbyopia.
Are you being difficult?
No, I think I'm
Get
being...
up against the wall. Get up against the wall. Spread them. Are you laughing?
Yes, because this is what I was looking forward to.
Oh, God. All right, we have case 257, Missing Michael. The mission. We have received information that Michael Caprio, the PR director of Chippendales, has been kidnapped and he is in danger. Your PR director has been kidnapped, so you all won't be able to do any more dancing for those ladies if we don't get them back. The boss has planted his spies throughout the city to take watch over the current situation. These spies are expecting a visit from informants whom they've never met face to face, but they are identified by a secret code word. The special agents are to pose as informants by using the code word to gain information where the ransom is going to take place and discover who the boss truly is, since we have no idea. So you guys get what's going on?
Yes.
All right.
You want us to pretend to be informants for the boss?
Exactly. Right. Man, he is bright. Your team must select a team leader, appoint a case file agent.
Spy games run corporate bonding and team leadership courses. All that management guff I've luckily been able to avoid in my life, that is, until now. Only this course seems rather more complicated than firing a paint gun at a portly middle management colleague called Dick.
The predictive text?
Yeah,
are you on our team as well?
Yes, I am on your team. I'm the only one who might look as if he isn't a Chippendale.
Right.
I'm tagging along today with some of the Chippendales, one of the big hits on the strip for the past 5 years. I don't know why they need this, but self-improvement is a fundamental American right, and they seem to take it pretty seriously.
Yeah.
Oh, gotta get the camera.
I'm so sorry.
I think we're off on the hunt to find informants who have been planted all over the city. And unless I've got it hopelessly wrong, my job is to sabotage the whole thing. Not quite sure how this helps team building. Maybe I'm a lesson in the limits of trust, or just a pawn in a game I don't understand.
Excellent. This is fun, isn't it? Nice pool, nice day.
Nice breasts. Anyway, what is abundantly clear is that Americans love this stuff and take it all on board without a hint of the sneering or cynicism that I fear my compatriots might indulge in. Not I, of course.
The boss talks about a guy named Weiler a lot.
Weiler.
Weiler. But I've never seen them together. The hostage exchange.
We have the phone number, the number of the picture.
Going to take place by the railroad tracks.
In essence, it's like a treasure hunt, and baffled as I am, it's an amusing way to see some of the mega resorts that have taken over the strip.
You've got the bureaucratic side of spying, you've got down pat.
One clue solved, so we're off to another of the many themed casinos.
Remind me what we're looking for here?
Well, we do not know. We are coming here and pulling it as a clue.
So we're just going to hope for a text.
You can also ask
Chug's Star Trek experience.
And now we have to find a man called Juggs, and we have to take photographic evidence of our meeting.
Excuse me, sir, would you be kind enough to take a picture for us?
Yeah.
That would be really kind, thank you very much. Here we go.
But being the cunning double agent that I am, I've turned off the flash.
Is it on the wrong setting?
Should be all right. I think James got it.
Well done, James.
I'm beginning to enjoy my duplicity. Maybe I should have taken that job with MI6 after all.
Uh-oh.
Oh, and I must exchange a token with Juggs without the chips twigging. All very spooks.
You're right, I'm so sorry.
You gotta make sure you shake Juggs' hand.
Juggs.
Right?
Had a handoff. He's tried twice to misdirect us in the directions. And
I think he cut the flash off.
He cut the flash off on the camera. He's trying to slow us down. He also keeps leaving the camera around and forgetting it. That's why we have it in Sean's hands now.
So we are at the Hilton and we're going to the Grand, we think. Yes?
Yeah.
One, two, three, four, five stops.
All right, gentlemen, we do have some things on our mind right now, and that is the mole. So everybody right now would empty their left pocket.
Ships. These are the payoffs.
Way to go. Gentlemen, I think we have found our mole.
I agree.
I think so, too.
Why?
Because, one, I saw you hand jugs.
Plus, when we were going to the Star Trek experience, you tried to misguide us. Even when I told you the right way, you tried to get us the other way.
Yeah, okay.
You also turned the flash off on the camera so we can get
it. And you tried to leave the camera at the bar. You set it on the bar as we started to walk away, and I said, go back for the camera. So with all these things, every time we've added up, we've talked it over as a group, we've officially decided you're the mole.
I have to admit, the Chippendales are not just a bunch of pretty pecs. And like so many Americans, they just seem instinctively to get this, whereas I don't. If only their foreign policy was this sophisticated.
I'm a weasel. I'll fight for anybody. Well, we seem to be reaching the climax of this thriller. We think so far. We've seen Wyler. That's the guy on the station here.
Yeah,
I think maybe the boss who recruited us in the first place, is actually the boss. Plus, there's the one who recruited me as a mole, who called herself Trixie. She's called Trixie, apparently. That's what she told me her name was.
So we make the rendezvous, and the game plays out. And, of course, it turns out that Trixie is probably the real boss, and, oh, who cares? What's important is that the chips are better bonded, and I've at least learned that I'm no more cut out to be a spy than a Chippendale. Oh, well, that's two more career doors slammed in my face.
One of the lesser-known facts about Las Vegas is that, in some respects, you could say the city was founded not by the mafia, not by property developers, but by the Mormons, of all people, the Church of Latter-day Saints. When they founded their home city of Salt Lake back in the 19th century, they then sent out other Mormons towards California, and every 50 miles, which was as far as a telegraph could reach without needing a relay station, they would set up a community, a settlement of some kind. And on the way, the 50-mile marker hit this little place in the desert. It seems a very, very unlikely mixture, Mormonism and Las Vegas, but I'm actually going to what you might call a secret photographic shoot involving Mormons right here in the city of Las Vegas.
How did you get this idea, Chad?
It actually came to me last year. I was talking with a bunch of friends, and I thought, wouldn't that be funny if, you see the firefighter calendars, you got the police calendars, the Marine calendars.
Yeah.
Well, what about Mormon missionary calendars? Yes, it's very tongue-in-cheek. It's very funny. It also has a really deep-rooted message about tolerance, about accepting, and about tearing down those religious barriers.
Is this the kind of thing that might cause the elders to frown and raise eyebrows, if you can do the same thing at the same time?
No. I think if we went any past this, they might, but, we're not doing anything that they could frown upon, and we're not breaking any rules. So.
No, right. What about the structure of the church, like in our Church of England, or the Episcopalian Church, as it's called in America? There are bishops and priests, and, there's a hierarchy, if you like. Is there a hierarchy? Also, you have elders, or what?
Yes. There's the prophet who oversees the whole church.
Oh, so there is an equivalent of a pope, an absolute head.
Correct, yeah.
We want this to be kind of a real angelic look, because that's like a belief, the Mormon beliefs are based on a lot of angels.
There is this thing about celestial,
the celestial kingdom.
So you could become an angel.
Right, no, well, it's more than just becoming an angel. Yeah. It's actually becoming resurrected. So the Mormon beliefs are, we live here on earth, we get a body of flesh and bone, you die, and then through the grace of Jesus, you're resurrected.
Right, so it is a Christian church.
Yes, and then one of the core beliefs of Mormonism, which causes a lot of controversy with other Christian faiths, is the fact that Mormons believe that they can actually become like God and become a god of their own universe as well, like the god of our universe. So,
in a strange way, science has at least vindicated the possibility by suggesting there could be an infinite number of universes.
It's interesting because the Mormon Church is very conservative, but their beliefs are very radical.
It's an interesting point. You're absolutely right. It's that mixture of the straight-laced sort of attitudes of no sex before marriage, no drugs, including alcohol, tobacco, caffeine, even quite minor ones like cups of coffee or Coca-Cola. Yet, on the other hand, the most extravagant beliefs for the future and in the nature of celestial transcendence and angelic beings and beatific, seraphic and cherubic hosts.
What language did you just talk to?
You lost me like about 20 words ago.
Oh, I'm sorry about that.
So do you think you'll have a career in the church, or will you have a...
No. I don't have the personality for it.
Really, yeah. Would you say that? What sort of personality do you need then?
I think you need a little more strict personality, a little more not smiley.
Do you think there's actually prejudice against Mormonism in America?
I really do believe that Mormons are looked at as a second-rate citizen.
I think some of the prejudices are just lack of education. Like as far as the gays and as far as the polygamists, they think that we believe certain things, which we don't.
There's a moment when you have to mention it to someone.
Right, and they're like, oh, and you may not see it on your face, but you feel it. You feel that, oh.
Ooh, a weird, or did people just go, oh, okay.
Yeah, sometimes people ask me how many kids I have or how many wives I have.
Really?
Or stuff like that.
Yeah, so you just get used to that.
I just laugh.
Rolls off you, yeah.
I mean, you are a proselytizing religion, though, aren't you?
Right.
You do want to convert the rest of the world to Mormonism, unlike
right,
Judaism.
So. Right, yeah, no, that's their mission. The mission of the church is to bring people in.
Yeah. And I suppose some people would object to that. I mean, there is you know, some people who just don't like the idea that they're going to be preached to.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I don't like to be preached to. Who likes to be preached to? And I think the mission of missionary work is not to necessarily go and convince people. It's to find those people who are looking for something, looking for answers. Yeah. And, you know, hey, this may work for you. It may not work for you.
Yeah.
And this is like the official uniform of missionaries. I mean, this is how they're identified. You got the white shirt, tie, name tag. Sometimes backpack, bike, you know. These are the guys that you see going door to door. And then the guys that we shoot, you know, that's them for who they, you know, who they really are to show. These guys are just regular guys, regular kids. I mean, they're young and they go out and they're 19.
That's brilliant. That is very funny.
That is hysterical.
They said I was being boring, so
really?
tried to spice it up a little.
What scripture was that?
Of course, there's more to Nevada than the new kid in the desert called Vegas. It's known as the Silver State for good reason. Gold and silver mining reached a peak here in Virginia City 150 years ago. 30,000 prospectors made this town one of the richest in America. And to help them spend their hard-earned scratchings from the motherlode came inevitably the gambling dens and the prostitutes. The mines have all but shut down now, but the whorehouses, like the casinos, are still booming, and only in Nevada they're entirely legal. Queen among them is the illustrious Mustang Ranch, run by its formidable madam, Susan Austin.
Hello, yes,
hello,
you must be Stephen.
I am indeed.
Hello. Well, what a pleasure to meet you.
It's a pleasure to meet you as well.
Thank
you. This is my first time in a brothel, I have to confess.
I have a brothel virgin on my hands. What fun!
You do.
This is our parlor. And this is where the ladies do their lineups. It's also where we have all our achievements.
Right. Is there an award industry for brothel?
Oh, yes, there is. You shouldn't be surprised.
Courtesan of the year.
I was trying to create a British gentleman's club where the old hunters could sit around in front of the fireplace and discuss the animals they have hunted in Africa as well as the women they've conquered.
It would raise a few eyebrows in the Garrick, which is a club I'm a member of in London, but...
Yes.
You've got comfortable chairs and dark wood. It's on
fireplace.
Its way. And you mentioned the lineup. Is that literally when a customer... What do you say, customer or John or...
Well, I use the
client?
Word client.
Client.
Client. Right. When a client comes in, we seat him right here, and then the ladies come out, one from each side of the room, one at a time, and they introduce themselves, and then they step back against the mirror.
Hi, I'm Mandy.
Mandy. Hi. Very nice to see you. Well, come sit down. I'm just here for a chat, as it happens.
That way, the gentleman can see them walk, talk, and up close, and decide whether that's the one he wants to pick.
See, you know, if I were doing that, I'd just be embarrassed about offending the one that I didn't choose.
Oh, no. I give a little preamble before. I say, honey, this is the way it works. All the ladies are going to come out, and they're going to introduce themselves. You pick the one you like. Now, if you don't come to a decision with her, you come out and pick another one. Remember, dear, you're not getting married. This is a business.
How did you find the first time? Was it nerve-wracking? Did you get help? Were you all psyched up for it?
I was nervous, but I had a friend of mine was here, and everybody, like all the girls here, are awesome, very awesome, just very helpful, you know. And they, it's like when you first start, you're either prepared to do it or you're not. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Having sex is very easy. When guys like you, it's that much more easier.
So, they choose And then the rooms are off here, are they?
And you haven't had too many weird requests yet, or anything?
Never, no.
No.
But what's weird to me is...
That's the point.
Far beyond what's probably weird to other people.
You're a young girl, an attractive young girl, and you might get some men like me coming in, great overweight, wobbly people in their 50s, and your heart must sink. You go, oh, God.
Not at all. Not with me.
You're no. okay with that?
That's why I'm here.
Yeah? Well, you like wobbly.
I love men of all different types, sizes, shapes. I do. I do.
And do you think
I
that's...
I love variety.
And you actually enjoy your work?
I love it. I love my job.
That's fabulous. Not many people can
say
that.
My mom knows, and she's like, I'm so glad you found a job you like. I like me too. I should have been here years ago.
Now, we're going to stop right here. These are our negotiating rooms. We don't discuss sex and money in the bedroom. Most brothels do. It has to be discussed in a private room. It can never be done in public. That's one of our state statutes. So.
Oh, this is by law.
By law. Yes. So this is where the men come in and talk about what they'd like to do, how long
how
many positions.
Right.
Yes, all the details. You have to know all the details.
And the girl will decide on the basis of what's required, how much
that's
it
how
cost.
She prices it.
And it's not your decision.
No,
as the,
it's not
as the
my
madam.
Decision at all. It's the really? Independent contractor. She is her own businesswoman. She sets her own prices. Yeah.
Right. So
now,
it's
by
like
state,
having the Louis Vuitton concession in a department store,
that's
as
right.
it were.
You, exactly.
Yeah, you are the department store manager, but they can charge
they have,
what they like.
They can charge yeah. what they'd like. That's what the traffic will bear.
Yeah. Now, if a man, if a man was doing it, even with, you know, Cialis and Viagra, mm-hmm. he'd be lucky to do it four times a day. Very.
Right.
And he'd be young and pretty, you know, mm-hmm. fit. After a certain age, he'd have to fake it, or he couldn't really fake it. Because, unfortunately,
right.
it's harder for a man to fake it. Mm-hmm. Do you actually find yourself orgasming many times a day? Can you do that?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
So that's...
Depending on the time. For me, I'm just kind of like a guy. A little time has to go in between there. It's yeah. not going to be like multiple.
No.
But yeah, I'll have a, you know, I'll enjoy a party with the customer and go back out to the bar and sit and talk with people and the next customer. It might happen again, and I'm like, I'm exhausted.
And do you think men know if you are faking it?
Probably.
Yeah. But you wouldn't.
I don't.
No.
After the discussion is done, the decision is made how much he's going to spend. She may not touch the money or the credit card until she's done what we call a DC.
A DC, okay, I'm trying to work this out.
Okay.
Not direct contact, not...
No, not direct contact.
DC, oh dear, no, it can't be that.
Oh, yes, it can.
Oh, no.
By state law, she must check the man's genitals.
Oh, my Lord.
Well, she's certified clean. She doesn't have any sexually transmitted diseases. So it would be foolish for her to go in a room with a gentleman and then get his pants down and discover, oh my God, he's got herpes. Or he has...
Some weeping wart.
Something, yes, something. And so we have a very bright light. We have warmed baby wipes because we know how sensitive you men are.
No,
oh, but it's fun.
Stop it,
it's
Susan.
Fun.
It's you, fun to show your genitals.
It's fun. What the girl says is, oh, we're going to play doctor now.
Right.
And she gets on her hands and knees with a baby wipe and the bright light, and she gets to fondle. But while she's fondling, she's checking every little area that's going to come
so
in contact with her.
Disease check.
Dick
right?
check.
Dick check?
I am really offending your British sensibilities, I can tell.
It's a little eye-watering, I have to say.
What would happen, though, if you met a man either who was a client or just a man you happened to meet in some other way, whom you completely fell for, who became the man. Would you still want to carry on working?
Yes.
Right.
If he was the man, he would have to accept that fact.
Right.
So we're first going to go into the Italian suite.
Oh, my word. This is very grand.
Isn't this wonderful?
This is not what I expected at all.
No, not at all.
This is like a four-star hotel. Are there many advantages to legalized prostitution, then?
When you control something like this and you make it legal, you have state statutes, you have federal statutes, everything that guidelines how you operate. So the girls have safety checks. They use mandatory condoms. Everything is done in a very legal, very safe manner. This is the mini Hawaiian vacation. Complete with chickens on the ground.
It's extraordinary.
The monies that are paid to the ladies now are taxable, so they become a productive member of society. They don't have a pimp beating them up, stealing their money. They're actually independent businesswomen. This is a wonderful sexual aid.
Mm.
Multiple positions. You just have to use your imagination. And if that doesn't work, we have a DVD on it.
I think I may need it. I don't think I could get in position one.
So it's a win-win when you legalize. But, as in Holland, you have to set the guidelines in, and they have to be guidelines that are enforced and properly done. Now we're at the Asian suite.
Asian suite. Now Asian suite. Oh, goodness. Chinoiserie a go-go. Look at that. Oh.
It is the oldest profession in the world. You can only hide it by not making it legal. It goes underground.
Yeah.
And the beautiful double-sized California King bed.
That is...
Now, that's a playground.
You could party on this bed, couldn't you? You
really... Yes. You could party on this bed and never run out of room. Yeah. And I've had quite a few groups who have.
Leaving the lubricious delights of the Mustang forever behind me, I head for the mountains and the purifying alpine air of Lake Tahoe that straddles Nevada and California. Once over the Sierra Nevada mountains, it's California with the scent of the ocean to lure me on. Unlike the pioneers and prospectors of old, I've had it pretty easy in my faithful cab, and I've now made it, as the anthem goes, from sea to shining sea.
Pacific Ocean. As Darwin remarked, a very badly named ocean. It's not being Pacific today.
It seems a long, long time ago and a lot of miles since I saw that first sunrise in Eastport, Maine, but the journey is still far from over. In the next episode, I discover the delights of San Francisco, travel up the Pacific coast, meet vintners and dope smokers, encounter Sasquatch believers and old believers, go hunting for whales and swimming with sharks.